Ben Niffen, and I'm obviously not Thomas Whip. Tom's out of town, he couldn't be here today, but I think we should take one of the best, and so I'm going to do this little intro for us. A couple things, we are kind of tight. I think we have enough seating for everybody, though. If you're on the back wall, we can get you a seat, but there are still a few seats left if you want to grab one. So for those who are new, MML, Midwest Manufacturing Leader, started about 2.5 years ago as a LinkedIn group online. My company, Link Selling, worked with Tom to spearhead that project. Now we've taken that out. It's become this real-world online event. We have speakers monthly events. Our mission is to strengthen the manufacturing community. And judging by the crowd we have here today, we got a lot of people who are interested in the topic of the speaker. Today we're going to be talking about lean, and we've had a lot of people requesting about the topic. Mitch Millstein, many of us have seen talk, an expert on all things supply chain and lean. Mitch spoke last September, I believe, actually at our second MML event. We decided to have him back because it's a topic everyone wanted to hear about, and Mitch seemed to be the guy. So I'm going to turn it over to Mitch, and he's going to walk us through today's presentation.
All right, I'm not going to use the mic. I think this is good. Alright, so we actually have a double presentation, and this wasn't listed, but we're fortunate enough, so the guy in the second row at the end here, Ray Keith, is going to come up after about 30 minutes, so I'm going to do about 30 minutes on my version of lean, and then we're actually going to switch, and Ray Keith, and I don't want to sound like I'm in the Ray Keith Admiration Society, but he's the real deal. Former Executive Vice President of Manufacturing for Emerson. So I've got a doctorate in supply chain. He's got a doctorate in experience. And 164 or 5 plants. So he's going to talk a little bit about his experience about lean. And we'll have similar presentations, but they'll be a little bit different. And hopefully for you, there'll be a ton of value in that. So me for 30 minutes, Ray for about 30 minutes. Questions whenever. Okay. Whenever you have a question, it doesn't need to wait to the end. We can absolutely positively stop as we go. All right, so I'm going to talk a little bit about lean, but before we get to the agenda, that's Paigiono, the guy who started this whole thing. I'm going to call the start of lean 1950, probably a little bit later, but let's call it 1950, soon after World War II and the rebuild of Japan. And this guy came in and developed it, and I always wondered, how come it didn't become a fad? Anybody see a pet rock recently? Pet rock? How about re-engineering? Anybody ever get involved in re-engineering? We map out the whole thing, forget the current state, build out the future state. I always bring this up because I worked for a company that implemented re-engineering. This is huge in 1992 only, maybe 93, but 94 it's gone. Because you spend a year mapping out the process, and then you go to flip the switch, and the new process doesn't work at all. So re-engineering came and went. Total quality management, self-directed work teams, even some of you are going to get mad at me because you've got green belts and black belts, but even Six Sigma is being pulled into lean, but 65 years later, we still talk about lean and Paigiono. I guess it works, right? Maybe that's why. Maybe because most of the tools that we're going to talk about in the current state of lean, not the new, really are things that you could have done when you were a fifth grader, right? Post-its, spaghetti maps, I'll show you some pictures. It's still around. It's absolutely amazing. 65 years later, I'm just amazed. We'll talk a little bit about definitions. Very briefly, talk about current tools and popular applications, the things that people are doing today in lean. That's not the subject of our presentation. It's really on these things. So I'm going to talk about what's new, and I'll do this from the perspective of Supply Velocity, my little consulting firm. Balanced scorecards. Theory of constraints, everybody here probably read the goal, or at least bought the book, if they didn't read it. And then probably what I'll spend a little bit more time on is the integration of supply chain management. For those that saw me last year, this is not at all a redo of that presentation, not at all, totally different, but it is, in my experience, what's new about lean and where it continues to grow, kicking out into the supply chain. All right, two definitions of lean that I use, identify and eliminate non-value-added work, ways. We'll go through and define those. This isn't a class. And people have used the word Buddha, the Japanese word, and all the other Japanese words related to it. So identifying, eliminate, non-value added is what I've been using forever. And the reason that it's worked so well for me, certainly as a consultant, is what business doesn't need that? So way back in, maybe it was 2003, as you all in business were starting to take this outside of manufacturing operations. In fact, I'll never say those two words together, lean and that other word, you'll never hear it from me. Somebody else is going to have to say it, because I'm not going to. Because it's so much more than just a manufacturing tool set. It's really about operations and about the enterprise. Okay? So, we make non-valued work. You want to do that in distribution. You want to do that in product development. You want to do that in purchasing. You want to do that in human resources. Sure. Absolutely. We want to do that everywhere. So, that definition works that I've given you here, or again, I didn't invent it. This other one is new for me, and I'm a researcher. I do research in cellular manufacturing and publish papers in journals that nobody reads as part of my academic work. And I found this definition from a guy at Indiana University, Swift, Need, and Flow. And he's really talking about reducing cycle time and reducing variation in processes. And this particular researcher, Roger Schwimmer is his name, says that if you look at all the improvements that we've had in productivity, whether it's Six Sigma, Lean, he goes on and even talks about supply chain, it's because we're trying to make the process both faster and more predictable. So two definitions, good one for you. That's not something that I've been talking about for a long time. So let's just very briefly go over the things that we do at Supply Velocity day in and day out. There's really two applications of Lean that for us are over and over and over we implement. And these are the tried and true ways to implement Lean. And one is process streamlining. So we like to use lots of colored post-its. Everybody thinks I have stock in 3M. I do not, just to go on record. But we use lots and lots of post-its, 489 of them in this orders delivery process. The manufacturing operation, this is a company that does have manufacturing operations, one post-it. Okay, so that was not our scope. It was everything else that goes on around this process. Now there's custom design and custom manufacturing engineering involved. This is a complicated process, but that's the process. Okay? So then, if anybody's worked with us and a few of our clients are in the room, we also maybe also like Avery, because we buy lots of those green, yellow, and red dots. And we put one on every single post-it, red, non-value added to the process, and it should be eliminated. By the way, if you want slides, just drop in your card. I'll talk a little bit about that at the end. I'd be happy to send this to you. Yellow, this is kind of new. We think we came up with this. It used to be either red or nothing, but we found lots and lots of processes that are certainly not value added to the customer, but without a doubt, it's things you have to do, right? You're not going to eliminate generating an invoice or all the accounting functions. They can be perhaps reduced, but you're not going to eliminate all of them. Chances are your customers would prefer not getting the invoice. So perhaps value added to you, but not your customer, we call that yellow. And then green, value added to the customer. So we put dots on every single post-it, and then we end up with something like this. So that's a typical, and many of you have been through this on your own with other consulting organizations. We can do dramatic reductions in number of steps involved in the process. Now, it's 2015. It took me about 2010 to get dragged into the information technology world, but this does include IT automation in here. We're not allergic to it. I used to be. I used to say, no, IT, everything has to be just policy change or other easy implementations, but now, finally, I believe in the power of IT. Started a software company, it's another subject. If you're interested, we can talk about it offline. Okay, so we map out business processes. And that happens day in and day out in Supply Velocity. It is probably going on right now. The other thing we do is facility layout. When I say facility layout, it could be big facility layout or a little facility layout. And actually, maybe Ned is going to see his facility coming up next. So one of my clients is right here, third row, and this is not him, but we're coming up next. So you can tell if I'm speaking the truth. Usually we don't get put on a point like that. So this is facility layout. This is a spaghetti diagram. If you're not using this in your lean events or lean projects, You should. It's very simple. Fifth grader can do it right. And incredible visual effect, right? So this is receiving an item. That's where you receive it, up there in the corner. And gets put away here, gets put away there. Lots of spaghetti. Really, the only purpose of this is to see where people go. It doesn't have any quantitative value, but it's really useful to make the case to people that why you go all over the place. I think I've got one more. Oh, I don't. I got more examples of this. If you want them, I'd be happy to send them to you. This is where the data comes. If you do a spaghetti map, do yourself a favor, do a time study. And our time studies are not industrial engineering time studies. They're simply going to look for, the colors look familiar, right? Red, yellow, and green. So all this work in this process, and another client here, so Kyle recognizes this, is not value-added work, and we did things to eliminate all of the steps that we have in that column. So for us, identify and eliminate non-value-added work. That's tried and true lead. That's the things that we do day in and day out. When it comes to layout, you like to think of things from an ideal flow, and so this would be ideal, right? Receive, produce, and then if you have some finished goods, pick, pack, and ship. And then we do paper dolls. If you haven't done paper dolls, they're a lot of fun, and you cut out lots of colors. And so this is a plant layout. This is the after, and it shows you the before that is related to that time, not that time study, this particular spaghetti map. Okay, so this is a next facility here in third row at CK, and so this is picking orders in a warehouse. So the previous one is manufacturing. This is production. This is distribution. Picking orders. We looked and found out where the top 250 of roughly 5,000 items are. So top 5%, where they located. The answer was all over. Okay, we didn't do that at first. We did this. We did the spaghetti map and said, why are they going here all the time? Why over here, and why back to this side? So we identified where they were. That's where they are now. What's even better, this is an old slide. If you have questions about warehouse facility layout, Ned's company, CK Supply, has gone even further on this. And that, of course, includes productivity, right? So these items are responsible for something like 60 to 70% of the volume that went through this warehouse. Now, people, they barely move, right? They just go to those places, get their items, pack and ship them, and life is good. So, that was my speed talking of the things that we do every day. Current applications. Still very useful, still used, still things that we do every day, and if you aren't aware of them, then hopefully there's some value to that. But this presentation is about what's new. So what's new for us is, I don't remember how long ago we did it, but maybe 5, 6, 7 years ago, we started to get into the balanced scorecard. And this is a particular example of a company that is anonymous in here, and this is their scorecard. This turns out to be really, really important for us. Lots of great to talk about this. I don't think it's the subject of this presentation, but he and I were talking before. Lots of lean implementations fail. Lots of lean, culture changes fail. You know, lean has been very successful. It's also had something of a rough track record as well. Okay, I'm sure all of you have been in cases or heard of cases where they tried it, it went away, what happened? 5 years later, another consultant shows up and recommends the same exact stuff. And to us, it's because you're not measuring it. So we start with this, just so you know. We never go into a lean implementation and jump right in. And I think Ned and Kyle, two of our clients in here, can attest to this. We start with a scorecard. I won't go into how to design a scorecard. Again, if you want these slides, I'll be happy to email them to you so you can get the template. I'll send you the template. It's fine. You can have this. Green, yellow, and red, you get the idea. We kind of like those colors. And so for us, if we're in lean, not affecting something on this scorecard, how's it going to sustain itself? Right? Lean is operational discipline. It takes work to keep it going. Well, if we're not improving something on the scorecard, then you can stop doing lean, and who's going to know? No one's going to know. It's going to get worse, and suddenly, you know, there's a hook on the wall for the broom, and there's a nice little sign. It says, broom, put it here. And where do you find the broom? Audience interaction part of the presentation. Where do you find the broom? Over in the corner is exactly the right place. Over in the corner is where you typically find the broom. That's lack of operational discipline because it doesn't affect anything on here. Nobody's tracking the results. lien goes away. So do yourself a favor, start with some scorecard. If you already have performance measures, make them visible. Okay, now we're actually working on an app to put it on people's smartphones so they can have it in front of them all the time. Today, we just stick it on the break room bulletin board. Okay, so we have to affect something obvious. We, in this implementation, we're affecting this and this. We're not affecting these two. We couldn't do everything. It was this one and this one. Previous, the next implementation of this company was right here. That's called new product development. Okay, so you have to work on things that you measure. You manage what you measure. That adage is true. It still works. Make sure that you're using performance scorecards first, or that you're affecting something on some type of scorecard that you're tracking. I just want to show you a little bit more. So this is the top level, the person that runs the business. This is his scorecard. His name is Greg. And that's the production one up to the left. Just a little point. We always like to start off with a little purpose statement. You can call it a mission statement. We like to avoid that word. It sounds kind of corny these days. But it is the same thing, but a purpose statement. Reliably produced and then machines always get better. This is engineering. You get the idea. It flows down. So if at all possible, we'd like to start with the general manager. It's not always the case that we do, and let it flow to the different departments. Sometimes we will start here and work our way back up. But you gotta measure. Various constraints. Everybody bought the goal, not everybody read the goal. Do yourself a favor and read it. Let's email me and we'll talk about it. It's a very big and part of me, us, and very important. So Ellie Goldratt said this a long time ago, it's still true. Anything that limits the system from achieving high performance versus its goal is a constraint, and that constraint prevents us from making money. So we try to identify the constraint. It's a simple concept. The only reason that Ellie Goldratt, by the way, if you've ever heard him speak, thinks everybody in the world has implemented theory of constraints. Very few people actually are, but everybody bought the book, so he's still raking in the millions for the book and thinks that all is good. Most people don't actually use theory of constraints, and he thinks they do because conceptually it's hard to implement. But I'd like you to think of it just this way. So it's a five-step process. Keep this in front of your lean efforts, and I think you'll be better off. So I'm not going to go through and read them. I cover this in one of my business process design classes at UMSL. I think it'll be useful for you. Again, get a copy of the slides. Always think about the constraint. How do we make it sweat? And how do we elevate its capacity? Move on to the next one. Okay, so if we're not working on the constraint, and we're not measuring success, our lean implementations, unfortunately, at supply velocity, we have 107 clients that we work with over 17 years, and not all of those have been successful. I'd love to say that. We're getting better, but early on, not all of them were successful because we didn't do this. So these things are now part of our practice. And again, this doesn't have to be a hard and fast implementation. I would just like you to put it at the front end of your implementation. Think about this, answer these five questions, then you can move on to me. All right. Now, I'm not going to redo last year's presentation about supply chain management. This isn't, but for us, this is where lean is going. And again, Ray's got a different but similar presentation about what he has done at Emerson. So for us, and this is really important, everybody, lean has moved into the supply chain. And I'm not going to say, you know, it's 2015. If your company has not ever started on lean or implemented lean, that's okay. There's lots of companies that have it. So if you feel like you've missed it, you haven't. You could start with the previous tools that I showed you. Process flow mapping, spaghetti maps, time studies, improving facility layout. Again, the things that are still happening every day. We have new clients that didn't implement lean prior to 2015. That's okay. If you have implemented lean, and these are things that your company has done, now it's time to move into the supply chain. So this is, I thought, maybe something a little controversial for the lean practitioners out there and the folks that have been doing it as long or longer than I have. To me, this is the Toyota Production System, Lean Thinking, Womack and Jones book, if you've read it. It's all about minimizing inventory. So they really got onto minimize inventory. And you may disagree with me, and that's perfectly fine, but I think the new lean is defined by Amazon, really an amazing company, and they've said it's about maximizing customer service. So, conversationally, I'll never forget when Amazon was building out its network. James Womack, the guy that wrote Lean Enterprise, Lean Thinking, kind of famous guy in the world of Lean, said that that company is going to fail and fall flat on its face because it's building warehouses, and those warehouses are full of inventory, and inventory is the thing we're trying to eliminate. Well, I think, you know, maybe it was 10 years ago who said that. Amazon's looking pretty good, right? Everybody here buy from Amazon, I do. It's just so darn convenient. They've made it easy. They're now going for same-day shipping. I mean, not with the drones, you know, that's a little further down the line. There's lots of things that have to get worked out in order for that to work. But they're doing lots of same-day shipping in major metropolitan areas. It's probably coming to St. Louis. As long as you're a metropolitan area, they want to do it. I'm working with clients that are working on the same thing. So suddenly, inventory, I know we have cellular manufacturing. That's actually my main research field. Cellular manufacturing, but cellular manufacturing is not going to make a single spare part that you don't currently have in stock and ship it to a customer next day. That's not going to happen. You have to have that in inventory. So if you're a finished goods distributor, you're actually in good shape. Well, not in good shape because you may be going up against Amazon, but that actually is what we're trying to do. So all the other costs, yes, we're trying to minimize everything else, but this is the thing that we're leading with, maximizing customer service. Really, we're going to define that as being able to ship something same day or next day, or within some time frame that the customer immediately wants it. One of my very strong clients right now is Total Hockey. If your kids play hockey, thank you very much, because you're buying thousands of dollars of equipment a year. Anybody here do that? Anybody here? $5,000 of equipment? No, no, no. It's a great sport. You should take it out. So we're doing this. We're actually working on same day shipping. Who needs same? Does a hockey player need same day shipping? Anybody think a hockey player needs something the same exact day? Yes. The answer is yes. Right? You break a stick. You need some more tape. Your helmet, suddenly the strap falls off. So we're doing that right now. It's not network-wide, we're not doing it all over, but we're building out. Remember Joey Womack talking about how Amazon fell down and, you know, they're gonna just go away. Amazon is gonna destroy. Well, we're doing that at Total Hockey. We're building out a warehouse network that should be able to reach, I think it's 80 to 85% of the hockey players in America in one day. And you know what that's gonna take? Warehouses and inventory. So suddenly we can't make it. It's mostly made in China. And we're the distributor. That's what we're talking about. So I would posit to you that this is where Lean is going. Maximizing customer service as measured. Doesn't have to be same day or next day shipping is a good way to measure that. So I have this little funny thing here I'm just going to go through. So is this Lean? Oh, this is the sales guy, by the way. And this is our people. She's the inventory manager. Sales guy says, he tells reps here, I apologize in advance. I heard this right out of our most popular item. If you don't mind, I'm going to read this off to you. You're going to agree. I just love this one. Yeah, we had a big order ship yesterday. Anybody have that? Sales guy goes into the warehouse and asks the inventory manager, what? We're running out of our most popular item? Sure, we had a big order ship the next day. Well, how the hell did that happen? I could put that down on here, but I appreciate it. And she says, well, if you ever want to run out, ask the CFO why I can't get more money. That's the solution, right? Just more dollars in inventory. I can assure you Amazon's solution is not just more dollars in inventory. It's called optimization. We're going to talk about that in just a moment. And while you're at it, this is where she really gets it, right? By the way, I modeled this off of this woman named Tracy. She's the inventory manager of this company, Swiss America, a client of mine. Totally see Tracy saying this. Picture that inventory manager saying it to the sales guy that's stupid enough to go into her warehouse. And while we're talking about it, how can you give me a better forecast? And now he's really sorry. And he finally says, well, if we keep running out of these items, we're going to lose customers. Does that mean? It's about inventory. Okay, Toyota production system, we should have no inventory, right? No inventory at all. But we have to have inventory. The question is, where is it going? It's going to optimization. The other thing that's happening is facility location optimization. And so if you're going to build out a network that's going to serve your customers in a very short cycle time, back to the first definition that I showed you, what's lean, reducing cycle time and variation, then you're going to have to put facilities in strategically located. Not where you want to go on vacation. Okay, there's lots of facilities in Florida and Texas for that reason. Okay? Not where your biggest customer is. That may or may not be optimal, but where it truly is optimal to put that in order to serve the most customers in the lead time that they expect. Again, let's use next day as a good barometer there. It doesn't have to be. So that's called optimization. This thing right here is just called an efficient frontier. If you're taking notes, it's a very important concept in lean supply chain, efficient frontier, which means you can have very high service and very high cost. That's okay. That's called lots of facilities. Maybe they're very small, which means you lose economies of scale, but that's okay because you want to be very close to every customer, total locking. Okay, that's where we're going. Or you can have a single facility. Do yourself a favor, put it in Louisville, Kentucky, because that is the logistical center of the United States, Louisville, Kentucky. That's why UPS has their facility there. Put your facility there, make one. Service is low, but also low, because you have all the economies of scale. One big facility, no duplication of safety stock, single manager, all the good advantages there. That's okay. What's not okay is this. Okay, so not being on the efficient frontier is not lean. Okay, so that is higher cost and lower service than what your competitors are doing. And this is all feasible. So this is facility location optimization. And it's something that we need to think about as we put facilities in place. So if you're moving or adding, think about reaching the most customers in the least amount of time. Okay? If you're not adding, that's all good. Just make sure you're not moving. Right there. Nancy, here, you can talk a little bit about this. So we've worked on lean at CK for 5+ years, and the results are absolutely amazing. I'll refer you to him to talk about what CK has achieved. We worked in the warehouse, we worked in the accounting processes, return, we worked in retail, all trying to make it more efficient. Where do we go next? And actually, I didn't come up with this, he did. We're working on vehicle routing. So trying to make sure that we're traveling the least distance possible. Because if you're going all over the place to serve your customers and you are in distribution, you own a truck, is that lean? And of course, I don't want you to have to yell out the answer. Of course it's not. It's rhetorical. It's not lean to go from here to here to here to here back to there because you forgot something. Over there, back there, back there. You forgot another customer you had there. And this is reality. And this is reality. This can be done with simple rules of thumb. In academia, we like to call that heuristics. If you've heard that term, heuristic is just a fancy word for rule of thumb. Or it can be done with a transportation management software system, TMS. If you've ever heard the acronym TMS, then that's what that is, transportation management software. And it's a very useful method for optimizing routing. So if you deliver, you need to think about making your transportation network lean, minimize distance, minimize miles traveled, maximize customer service, okay? All right, I'm almost wrapping up. This summer, I went to the Grand Canyon and grew a beard. And first time in my life, I grew a beard, and it came in white. And I'm only 48, I thought I probably look a little older even without the beard, but I look 65? All that bad. But it was professorial, and I am a professor, so I thought I would throw that picture up of what I would like with a beard. So here's what I'd like you to think about before I hand it over to Ray Keith, who will give you the practitioner side versus the consultant academic side. Process flow mapping, you know, post-its on a piece of brown and white paper and a little red, yellow, green dot, super useful. Spaghetti map and time study, and using that with paper dolls to do facility layout, incredibly useful, happening every day, hopefully in your facilities. Great tools to use. But if we don't start with the scorecard, then don't blame anybody else. You can blame the consultants, we're used to it. But anybody else for the efforts didn't work. Because if we can't track improvements, that we don't know if things are getting worse. And we have that, right? So we actually had that at CK. We worked on a project a long time ago. It's on a scorecard. It got better. I mean, much better. And then it plateaued. And then it got a little worse. So what are we doing? We're working on it. We're going to the next stage to make it better. We're re-correcting some of the things that got off track. But we didn't do it 10 years later. We did it as soon as that turn started down, because Ned looks at that measurement every month. Regress theory of constraint. Use it as a theory. Underline the word theory. It's not a real implementation method. Again, Goldratt would believe that everybody's implementing theory of constraints. I want you to use it as an overriding concept. And as to me, big lean, you don't have to use that term. I'm probably never going to use it again. I don't want to try to create a new term. But big lean is about applying to the supply chain. And that is not going into your suppliers and trying to make them lean. That's good. If you can do it, great. Most companies I work with would resist that. If somebody wants to go in and tell them what to do, there's all kinds of bad stories about GE goes in and learns more about your business than you even know, and they use that to beat you down. I'm talking about, instead, routing optimally, an optimal warehouse network, an optimal set of inventory and inventory levels, and then routing optimally. And these optimization tools are mathematical tools. You could use heuristics, rules of thumb, they're perfectly good, right? We want to be no more than 500 miles away from 80% of our suppliers, customers. You can do it on the supplier end as well, but customers is more shipments. That's a perfectly good heuristic to use, but use it. Don't just say, looks like we should stick one in iron. Okay? So all those tools are part of what I call implementing, which is really how do we take waste out of your supply chain. And when I say supply chain, I really still am not even talking about all your suppliers, but just your direct supply chain network, the things you control, your trucks, your warehouses, the amount of money you put into your inventory. Those, to me, are the things that are part of where we're going with lean. At least we are a supply process. So that is my story. I intended to do this for 30 minutes, and that somehow worked out well. If you want to ask questions, you can, but maybe at this point, Wade, I think you've got about 20 minutes, right?
Make it
25 minutes? We'll do questions for Ray and I at the end.
I'll switch over for Ray.
Quality, asset usage, very much success. However, lead times from the real customer point of view is still being challenged, and delivery reliability is still not the best. It's sort of like you can optimize the shop floor all day long, but if you surround it with chaos, it's not going to get that much better. It looks good, the room is in the right place, the tables are shiny, everything is clean, and you see happy people wearing uniforms, or whatever the case may be, whatever your definition of lean is. So then later on in the journey, expanded it to the lean enterprise, and what Mitch was talking about, getting everybody on the lean bandwagon, whether it's the accounting side of the business, the procurement side of the business, engineering, whatever, and information flow became very critical, and quality was enhanced, but there were still challenges. We were still working inside the four walls of the company. When we really stepped back and looked at it, we found one of the real root causes, if you will, a constraint. I'm not exactly a constraint, but in that way, and it was complexity. How in the world could we possibly try to run a business that was overly complex? Now, let's look at Emerson for a moment. We lost track. We didn't even know how many customers we had. We stopped counting at about 65,000 customers. 850 different SKUs we were purchasing from 28,000 suppliers, going to 270 facilities around the world and trying to serve all those customers. Way too complex. The complexity in and of itself became a constraint on moving forward in our lean journey and attacked that very much. Now, the interesting part of attacking complexity. Now, on the lean journey, it was literally the first time all the constituents in a business were at the table with a shared goal. So you had the design engineers there, you had sales at the table, you had marketing at the table, you had finance at the table, operations at the table, procurement, supply chain at the table, all going after a common goal, and that's reducing complexity. That led us evolve into demand-driven supply chain. We now have all the constituents at the table working on the same set of financial and business goals, instead of all working on optimizing the room. You know, how many more new products can I introduce? What kind, you know, how can I promise my customer even more mix that they could buy? Let's double the size of the catalog. All those kind of things. That's optimizing my function. Now we're working all together. Okay, any product or service. Now this is going to have a manufacturing event, but any service has a value chain. Mitch showed you a picture of a classical value chain over, starting with the customer's customer, going all the way back to the supplier. And quite often it's more blocks than that. From the point of consumption, the real consumption of the product or service, back to the origination of the materials that are being used through the value chain to be able to create that consumption. It's usually complicated, and linking this is very difficult due to variation. You heard Mitch talk about variation. Key issue right here is variation. Demand and supply chain is really a series of data-driven methodologies, along with partner collaboration, customer collaboration, supplier collaboration, to reduce this variation, increase speed, and increase efficiency. You'll notice the words are very similar to what Mitch and I use. Get together about once or twice a year, and somehow we still use the same words. Here's just a picture of what I call demand-driven supply chain. There is no starting point and there is no ending point. It's a circle. The key elements in this is, here's our lean execution side, lean execution, master scheduling, level loading, lean, pull. There's the execution. Quite often execution, though, is limited or constrained maybe by how demand comes in. Remember the example with the supply manager and the sales manager, seen that many times. We just sold out of our highest running item yesterday due to a big order. Now, who ordered it? It was probably a B customer that only got around to ordering once every 60 days.
What do you do about that? Now, interactive. What do you do about that? B customer comes in, cleans the shelf out. Huh?
Save some, don't ship them all.
There you go. Don't ship them all, but what made them first?
Ask us to eat all of it at once.
Yeah. Are you going to use them all tomorrow? No, that's my next 60 days of supply. Got a deal for you. I'll ship half now and half in a month. So you don't run out. That's demand management, demand shape. It's as simple as that. Demand visibility. You really know what the demand looks like in variation and reducing that variation. This is a new area, fairly new area, I should say, in the lean journey, is really working that demand can be managed. It can be managed, and that variation component is so important. But then you have to get our design side of the business involved also. Have we made designs that are flexible to build and ship? Can we do late customization so that we're not putting everything on the shelf in a finished goods state? Supply chain collaboration. If you're in manufacturing, engineer components in particular that we buy from suppliers, we design them and ask them to make them. We're not experts in that. They're the ones who know how to make them. Get them involved with the design chain. Supply chain architecture design. We saw a lot of that from Mitch also in terms of transportation management. But build where you sell or sell where you stock if you're in the distribution. Supply-based location criteria, I'll give you an example on that in a moment. Again, how we reduce variation. When our suppliers are not performing, whose fault is it? Anybody?
Our fault.
Often it's our fault. We're introducing variation, we're introducing bullwhip into the supply chain, and then we give them a bad scorecard. So we need to be measured in those things. And pull whenever possible, which helps reduce variation. The idea of pull and Kanban has been around for a long time. In fact, you'll see a Kanban if you go through the exhibit at Toyota in Japan. And it was an assembly line in 1935. And there's actually a two-bin Kanban using wooden bins. Showing on that assembly line. And yet, people are scared to death to pull. Instead, they want to do that infamous forecast, and they really screw it up. And then we always have to execute smoothly again. So we're back in the circle. So case examples. Major customer, number one customer. This is their order pattern by week to one of the businesses that I used to be a part of. How in the world can you service that customer? Tons and tons of inventory. Number one customer. In fact, it was 47% of total volume with a 98% order variability. Then you've got into their system with permission and says, how are you really using them? This was a central warehouse. So here's how the build-out is in the network business. Here's how the build-up was actually pulling from the warehouse. They were pulling like this, but the warehouse was ordering like this. Why? Forecast. All these guys out here would always over-forecast. In fact, most of the time they would say they were going to build a lot more than they had in the remote capacity to build. And then they build it all up. And so when all this got ordered, what do you do now? Well, the CFO was bugging the hell out of the procurement inventory people. So what do you do? Nothing. You start draining the swamp and then wham, again. So what we did here is went together and did vendor managed inventory and says, let us monitor your inventory and we will pull from ourselves to fill up your inventory for excellence in customer service. You won't have to run out. You don't have all this kind of stuff. And everybody improve customer service and reduce inventory. Identify the variation, do something about it. In the design world, there was an interesting series. This particular product platform was serving 65% of the market after they redesigned 95% of the market. Good deal. However, when they redesign, they ended up cutting the number of components used in half, and almost about two-thirds reduction in the number of suppliers required. By designing this product, the ultimate flexibility is configurability at the end of the line. So matching flexibility. $2 million cost reductions, got rid of all those 9 regional product families, expanded market served, increased sales by a substantial amount. Just through the design side, it was that upper right-hand part of the wheel. Having a strategy on where you're going to source. So this is just a map of a global operation. And what they would do is look at the demand variation on those particular components, how we consumed it and how it was demanded. And for stuff with low demand variation, yes, we could get it from China Inc. or anywhere else over in Asia and ship it all over the world because we could have a pipeline with low demand variation. However, there was components of high demand variation. Those you can source regionally. So you have a nice blend. It's not an all or nothing. It's not just a cost decision. It's not just an inventory decision. We're talking about speed to the customer, excellence in customer service, at a low cost, what makes sense. So stratifying your supply chain. Another one of the operations, now we're getting into value chain. They mapped quite a bit, and this is just a very high level value stream map. Now their customer, them, their first tier major supplier, second tier major supplier, and to get from this supplier to the hands of the customer, the real consumption point right here, it was 82 days of lead time. Went on a campaign to put in pull throughout the value chain, so they actually have the customer pulling from us with a Kanban signal, electronic, by the way. In turn, that would translate into a pull from the consumption point of view for the first tier supplier, who in turn was putting in a pull system along with us. It was a one pull system for the second tier supplier. Got it down to 42 days. Big difference in that whole world. Speed, customer service, low cost, low inventory, actually, in this case. Now the next step in this process, it's already been done, this slide is old. Why in the world do we have a variation of a Kanban mix supermarket right here? When no matter what we need, it's definitely going to have to be eventually signaled back here and made here. This is the raw component, this is the machine, here's the delivery. So why not just send the signal right here, send it first in, first out, right through here. Because if we need it here, we don't have to have them worry about scheduling it. It comes in the door, you machine it, and go. This is high mix model, by the way. So, now I'm going to summarize here, because we hope that there's going to be some interesting discussion and questions for Mitch and I. So I want to get through. I just want to put the big picture in front of you. Here we go. Demand management, design for supply chain architecture, and lean execution. Not any one of these can truly be optimized in and of itself and be declared a success because it will fall apart somewhere else. They are interactive. So often, execution depends on eliminating demand variation. Demand variation is often caused by poor execution. If you're missing your deliveries and you're inconsistent on your lead times, customers will order in a strange fashion to try to overcome it. So these two interact, and around the wheel. So the whole point is, we're always looking for, again, I'm going to go to Mitch's word, I never used it that much before, constraints. Something in this system is constraining the next level of performance. Where is it? Have we measured it? Now we continue to measure it. So, excuse me, I'm going to need my water here in a minute. We have, about 10 minutes? Maybe close to, yeah, about 10 minutes? For any of us, what about discussion? And I would suggest, Mitch, come up, we'll just do this kind of together, we'll practice. What kinds of discussions?
discussion points that might there be?
Ray, you mentioned, if I heard it correctly, you used the word infamous forecast.
Yeah.
All right. We're integrated. I get all this, we buy into it, and we're a manufacturing company here, and it's a whole line manufacturing company.
Yep.
But the empiricals of all the stuff that you both are talking about are absolutely identifiable and real. But that forecast, that infamous forecast, I think the word infamous should relate back to what drives that forecast, and that's the infamous bank. Because they are always going to be in your business now more than they ever have, especially since the recession. So they're always driving you to say, what are you going to do, what are you going to do, what are you going to do? So the empirical side of this is really good, and it's very clean, it's very healthy. The real world is, you've got to maintain some balance with the bank's demands versus what you feel is going to be best for your business, bottom line.
I'm not really saying the forecast is totally worthless, but if you execute, and you try to get down to too fine a granular level to execute to a forecast, you're probably going to create variation in your system, forecast variation, and that creates demand variation, yes. All the rest of that stuff. A good business forecast at a little bit of a higher level that makes sense, that is capacity understood. That's the one thing I've seen in forecast everywhere, people forget that capacity has a limit. So they forecast things they can't do, and then wonder why they didn't do it. And yet we're trying to drive a procurement system with it. So when I say infamous, I mean how we use it, and if you use it for execution, that's why I'm a big on compound and pull. Because that's what's real. The forecast is not real, what we consume isn't. So that's where my work came from.
I agree.
Been fighting that forecast out over here.
It's just the intangible sometimes gives in the way of something, and you have to, the bank is going to insist on certain things, because oftentimes they don't understand maintenance.
Mm-hmm.
They really don't. So you have to educate them as well as to why you're doing things in a certain way. And it takes a lot of time to manage your business.
Yep. Well, of course, if there's bankers, then there's corporate entities like I had at Emerson that wants every number known to mankind sliced three ways. So, yeah, they all have it, and they live and die on the business forecast. So I understand that. Just don't translate it into execution.
Can I throw in this before we get your question? I do have a different perspective because I've got a lot of distributor clients. And so I will do a distribution view, not manufacturing, of forecasting. To me, well, I tell you, my clients, we actually, the software company I started earlier this year, we have a forecast engine. And it uses forecast algorithms. They're optimized to minimize error. And so we are predicting the next couple of months' demand using tried and true forecast algorithms, exponential smoothing, been around a long time. If you use them in an optimized fashion, I think they're going to benefit. But I want to go just a little bit into that's a piece of forecasting. And so to me, there is sales and operations planning, which is sales reps guessing, constraints, on this capacity. So understanding what our capacity is, getting their guesses, and then filling in the blanks, because if you sell 5,000 items, they're not guessing on how many? More than 200 of them? Something, if you're a finished goods distributor, has to predict somehow, especially if your supplier is not in a compound situation. Now, if you're a distributor, chances are you're buying from a manufacturer who does not have finished goods inventory. That's why you exist. They're producing it. And even if they use lean, cellular manufacturing, again, that's my field of academic study, it's going to be a few days to get to you with transportation, and there's always minimums. So I think using statistical algorithms to forecast. Next month, 2 months out, that's it. It's hard to go really past that. With a sales and operations planning process where sales reps are guessing, and then somebody pulls the two together, if you're a finished goods distributor, that's part of that business. That's Ray is talking about. But again, very focused on the finished goods distributor. They have to forecast in order to have some idea, because somebody's saying what the inventory level should be, and that has to be based on what you think you're going to sell. You got to come up with some way of doing it. You could calculate it, you could guess it, you could ask the sales reps. Someone has to come up with that number, because otherwise your warehouse is empty. So I think it's a combination of statistical forecasting, sales and operations planning, done on a monthly basis. If it's done on a quarterly basis, no good. If you forget a month, no good. It has to be part of your monthly rhythm that you're doing that type of work. So that's my take. A little bit.
And actually, we actually agree on that. And I'm going to bring one more in there. The guessing forecasting. I know three businesses. I know one big one out there in the world that puts it compensation, part of compensation in sales and marketing is accuracy of forecasting. I don't see a lot of people doing it. I don't see a lot of people doing it. So a measurable one, and then I haven't seen a lot of people do that. They just let them over forecast.
So, I'm sorry, this guy right here was the next one.
We're talking about building complex systems across teams, sometimes across businesses. What's the most effective way to get these people with different interests to buy into this common theme?
That's yours. If you can measure the win-win situation.
In terms of what?
Financial returns. Win-win. I never could go to a major supplier and tell them we're going to make him better unless I can show them what the benefit is for him, not just the benefit for us. When the procurement world has the strategy of what's ours is ours and what yours is ours, that relationship is not there. If you can come up with a win-win, how we both decrease transportation costs, we both decrease expediting costs, we both decrease inventory, now we can talk about a common set of things. So it's always in the measurables, but it has to really be a win-win. Introducing Kanban to a customer saying, you use our Kanban system, is an interesting conversation. What's in it for them? Well, we did the curve, actually. So, well, our normal lead time is 4 weeks. You go on our Kanban system, we'll take it 2 weeks. And not only that, we'll only charge you 3% for being on our system. And we actually got by with a price increase. Because we were able to take delivered reliability from the low 90s up to about 99 plus with half the lead time for all these distributors.
What's that? There's value to that.
There's a lot of value to it.
Yeah, cost increase costs.
Yeah, a lot of value.
Yeah.
We have a question back here. Let's talk about order, and then we're going
to have a question.
Now, you've talked about your experiences with a few lean processes or ventures, and a number of them haven't worked out. So what would you say has been like a common denominator, main reason for the those not working out?
I'll give you three answers. One is actually you guys. So it's you. I'm never supposed to. Client's always right. In this case, it's you. If you are in middle management and you didn't buy in, you're no good. Now, not the owner. So if anybody here is the owner of the company, executive vice president, or CEO, that's who buys. So when you buy consulting, at least when we sell consulting, we're always selling to the owner, CEO. Nobody but that person ultimately decides whether we're coming into the company. Even very large companies, or high level, we sold to Ray many, 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 many years ago. High level people. It's the middle level managers that for us can be the ones to get around. And the other are the things that are addressed in there. So we didn't use the two balance scorecards, we didn't measure performance, things fell apart. No kidding. We weren't measuring when we were improving. They weren't on anybody's radar. We did improve that. It got better. Nobody measured it. They stopped doing the lean work. It got worse. Nobody was paying attention. 6 months later, what was that company that used to have in there? So it was the measure. That scorecard is the biggest piece. And then middle management. But we can get them on board with the scorecard. So that scorecard for us holds a lot of value. Because they create it. You don't bring in Ray to create a scorecard for a plant manager. He reviews it. But we're doing it with the plant operations people, with the warehouse operations, with the purchasing manager. I can show you HR examples that they're creating their own scorecards. They're on board. try to go in order for this gentleman.
I'm just curious about what your feeling is on the untapped market for leading, you know, based on by industry, manufacturing, supply chain. I mean, what percentage of companies haven't done any of this yet and could potentially just sort of all
of them? Suppliers probably better than that.
I'd say the untapped market is probably still in the 75 to 80%. Easy. I can even tell you, I mean, I spent 15 years, you know, trying to changing Emerson. And, you know, that was full speed ahead. That was Chuck night and day far behind it, and on and on and on. And it still has an untapped potential of 50%. As I walked out, of course, we had to do the 80-20 rule. What did we really go after? The big money makers, right? Those are the ones that got the attention. The little guys got swept under the rug a little bit, and if they wanted to pay attention, they could. They didn't have to. But I'd say in the general marketplace, because I do a lot of talks on a lot of different industry settings, and, you know, like healthcare things, 5S, and the one supply chain Kanban total that they've done lean. Or the colored stripes in the floor and say, here, if you want to go to OR, you know, follow the red line, and they call that lean, not even colored stripes. But that's a whole cultural paradigm in healthcare in and of itself.
How about one more question this minute here, and then we'll wrap it up, I think, around our
okay, we're talking about the new lean being maximizing customer service, and time was a big part of that. In our situation, our president, as he has said, time's not really an issue because we deliver commercial windows. They have a certain date when they want those windows delivered. You know, a lot of things common sense. We understand, you know, responding immediately to customer calls, trim kitting, what we're doing, we're going to add in 20 boxes, just one box for each window. Different things like that, the common sense stuff, you know, quality product. For the new lead, is there any other types of things that we can focus on for customer service since time is not an issue?
Well, I would suspect that time in a way could still be an issue. Not necessarily a constraint, but how you stratify your marketplace and then how you would in turn, are you just doing distribution or internet?
Just distribution, you said.
Okay, because if you were doing manufacturing, it's how you do the master scheduling to allow flexibility so you don't over-promise something, you always have some capacity available. But in distribution, quite often, lead time stratification. I ran a healthcare distribution company many years ago for doctor's offices and small clinics, 10,000 SKUs and all that kind of stuff. Certain customers got excellent time, 10-day shift. Other customers got shipped in 3 days, and other customers got shipped in a week. It will balance the flow of stuff going in and out in my workload that way. But, you know, Eric is a customer, ABC customer, ABC customer, ABC supplier. To me, ABC is one of those things that Mitch could have on his thing. It's one of the all-time tools of an ABC analysis. We discussed that on the ad nauseum program. So sometimes stratifying things to align with what you want your core market to do makes a difference.
Hey, I think we're at our time limit that you all were expecting to go. So if there's more questions, I think Ray and I will hang around. We'll take them. If you want a copy of my slides, then just email me. It's on my email. Or drop me a card, and I'll hang around a little bit. And thanks to SWIP and MML for having us.
Give a hand to our speakers today.